Okay. All right, they do ban Yember.
There is like a high level of security regarding all of this because of what is at stake. So I think it's only fair that these things are being enforced.
Yeah, for sure. I'm just wondering if Mineski did the same thing in game one.
I think it was the bags, man.
That's the docs here again. This went pretty fast. Okay.
Is that almost identical bans? Almost.
They banned Ember.
Yeah.
Yeah. What did they ban in game one instead of Ember?
SF?
No.
Not
SF?
No. It was...
They banned the Slava and Secret banned the Shadow Priest.
Dazzle.
Yes, that's right. It was Dazzle in the first place.
So I'm just thinking right now, based on what we've seen from Secret in general so far in this tournament, Envy has played Doom, Ember, and Anti-Mage. Exclusively, or has it one game on another hero? Because two of them are banned already, so Mineski might just be targeting him full out, knowing that they can ban him in second place. He played Wraith King? Okay.
So Melina has been talking a lot about this Roshan control, and one of the things about Secret is, and one of the things about a lot of these teams here that are performing exceptionally well, are that they love playing the Dire side. And I would love to see the winning percentage of Dire against Radiant, because it does seem heavily favored towards Dire.
I think in this version, in competitive Dota, there was a very high win rate for Radiant, but I don't know if it's the case for this tournament. Which would be really interesting if it's not, because I remember it being so significant that people were starting to talk about nerfing Radiant. I think it was something like 55% win rate for Radiant in all competitive games in 685, something like that. Could be wrong on that, but... I do agree, though. I think the Dire Roshan advantage is pretty crucial, and if the teams are starting to figure out how to deal with the Radiant lane advantage, then Roshan definitely means more past minute 20 than Radiant's advantages do. 5 seconds. Right. Brood A. They're going to ban Huskar again, Secret. No chance is taken.
I'm actually not that surprised to see them take Nightstalker in the first phase. I don't think they picked it at all during the group stage, but I think that's one of Mineski's biggest weapons.
Yeah. So when Secret play Nightstalker, do they ever put it offlane, or is it always Pilotite playing it? I don't think Puppy plays this hero. I don't recall
Misery's played it
ever
for sure.
Seeing it on him.
He played it before Stardar got super popular.
Before it was cool.
Yeah. So what other strategies do Mineski have?
There we go.
Sometimes they run the Alk, although not very successfully.
So now it's probably an Envy Quap, I guess. He also loves
that
hero.
They have played some safe lane Shadow Fiend.
Yeah, they play it either way.
Okay.
But I would agree with you, I think.
I think it's interesting to see these teams draft a Darkseer Wyvern as the opener. We've seen it in a lot of games. And I feel like there are very few moments in games where you're just like, wow, there was that vacuum Winter's Curse combo. Mm. But perhaps it's also just half of it is about the threat that the enemy team can't position like they want because they always need to be wary of it. But at the same time, you're already wary of Darkseer alone.
Yeah, both heroes are very strong at their position as well. And if we look at Mineski's offlaner, the only two heroes he's been playing throughout the tournament is Slada and Darkseer. So it might also be about being comfortable.
Yeah. Oh, I'm never going to question a first phase Darkseer pick in this version, I think. I think it's always... It's so flexible.
Are we by chance going to see Wisp Tiny?
I like the combination of playing a carry that's good at split pushing together with Darkseer, because Darkseer will always be shoving the one lane with Ion Shells, and then you have a carry on the other lane. They could even consider going for the Anti-Mage that we were talking about earlier, also to steal it away. Ah, Secret won't run that with this. That's too much, isn't it?
We've seen weirder things, and...
They're definitely taking their time here. Maybe they did want the Shadow Fiend.
Yeah, if you look at what Benton picked right now, Imbo's played hero pool so far is down to a Windranger. with the TA ban and Shadow Fiend being picked up, Ember Spirit ban.
It's a pretty good win trend again. Yeah.
And there we go.
Nice. This time around, I like Secret's Draft a lot more against Meniscus than in the last game. I think they have all the tools they need right now to make this work.
Oh yeah, it's a really strong lineup.
So are we looking at safe lane Queen over safe lane Shadow Fiend?
Yeah.
I think so. It'd make the most sense. I think Team Secret should be looking at banning out the anti-mates for their last one.
If Meniscus wanted, they'll pick it now. Secret has shown so much of their hand, this has got to be a safe lane Queen of Pain, a support Dazzle, obviously, and then Nightstalker could still be a support. That's the only one that isn't given. Mm. Or
they do pick up the Undying, so only the carry remains. He does play all of the carries, more or less. He can go for a Gyrocopter or even a Juggernaut.
This also sits up well into the Anti-Mage if they want to go for it still. It's what we were talking about before the draft even began, that Meniscus can try to play this very heavy aggression, but also ensure their late game this time around. 5 seconds remaining. Undying is one of the best heroes at enabling an Anti-Mage, because it's very difficult to challenge into, so AM will be farming. And if you don't challenge into it, he's also great at pressuring the enemy's safe lane and taking towers early just to open up the map.
But looking at the Meniscus lineup, if you're a Secret right now, do you fear a Gyrocopter more than an Anti-Mage? Just through the sheer synergy with the lineup?
You fear a PL?
Okay.
It seems. Or they go all in and greed and they grab the AM now, and then they play an offlane Queen of Pain with Dazzle, Nightstalker as the supports.
I think
that's pretty greedy, though.
By what Meniscus said, how they wanted to go in their face at all times, I think Gyrocopter is a lot better pickup than the Anti-Mage. Instead of trying to contest Secret for the late game, just go for this all-out early game pressure, the same way we saw Alliance do yesterday up against Cloud9.
Gyro's definitely good here. They could also consider, I think this is, you need to go back a little bit, but there was a phase when Meniscus actually really liked playing Spectre. That is a possible pick in this game. Secret has very limited potential, I feel, for pressuring her out of lane. But it does put a lot of pressure on the other heroes to be able to win fights while she farms. And I could see them do that with this lineup.
Yeah, I think with that, either Spectre or AM, they can feel pretty comfortable in their late game and play it much at a much slower pace than they did last game, although that doesn't necessarily suit their style. But it's still nice to have that comfort. We have better late game.
Doesn't suit their style and leaves more room for error. The longer the game goes, the more mistakes can happen.
Mm-hmm. But at the same time, Secret have like really strong lanes right now.
Oh, Tidehunter, great reset. They do go for the Anti-Mage.
Okay, lineups are locked. Time for game two of Team Secret versus Meniscus.
Indeed, thank you very much, Paul. We're ready to get ourselves into game two between Team Secret and Meniscus, and the drafts are out. Final pick, Tidehunter. Talk to me about it, Kevin.
Tidehunter. He's so much fun. He has tons of cosmetics, because that's all I care about. But great teamfight hero. He has a spell called Ravage. It stuns pretty much everyone in the fight. So what's probably going to happen, especially with the Anti-Mage pick on Meniscus, is they're just not going to want to fight that often. So they need to give themselves a little bit of space. They need to make sure Tidehunter doesn't get the fastest six, and then they should be okay for a while. But even with that said, Secret can still farm very fast with Shadow Fiend and Queen of Pain. And they also have pretty good Anti-Mage gank options with Queen of Pain and the Nightstalker. So it might be a little hard for Cuckoo to stay alive on Anti-Mage. We'll see.
Okay, I mean, in terms of the lineups, we're seeing some stuff again. Obviously, the fact that Meniscus, they really prioritize that Darkseer pick. They get it first. And Ryo, in the first game, he did a good job at farming, but there never really was the opportunity to find a good kind of five-man vacuum wall against Secret, because they just played so well around the team fight.
Yeah, they did. And it also had to do with the stages of the game that they're in. In the early game, Meniscus wanted to get a lot of ganks off and be aggressive. But in the mid-game, when they had no stuns to lock down the Black King Bard Ember Spirit, then they didn't want to fight. So I think that's just a natural progression of the dodging that happened a lot during the game.
Here we go.
See if you can do it this game.
And I mean, in terms of dodging the fight last game, this time with a Tidehunter, you think they'll be looking for more fights in the mid-game Secret?
Secret definitely will be. Meniscus maybe as well, but it's much more likely that there'll be four-man engagements while Anti-Mage is somewhere else. Or there'll be fights somewhere where an Anti-Mage could show up to TP to a tower and then join the engagement. Tidehunter offlane versus an Anti-Mage, though, it's not really a good situation, because while he can deny Anti-Mage's farming, Anti-Mage will drain his mana, and then Tide is basically just like a walking, damage-blocking, mana-less hero. And it's, he is going to have these mangoes, which will help, but there's possibilities that the supports could just leave Anti-Mage in a 1v1 at some point when he has the level advantage over Tide, and not really have any threat there.
It looks like Secret were looking to get the bottom room, but realizing that the Mineski are there, not really wanting to go into a fight. Head up towards the top, Pylai die. It's forcing Darkseer away from any chance of sneaking in that rune. And looks like they'll both go the respective ways. And in terms of the lane matchups, as you said, starting off, you can imagine that we're going to see a lot of backup for the Anti-Mage down there, and then the rotations will come out from Mineski's lineup.
Yes, most likely. Because again, Anti-Mage can just solo versus Tidehunter so easily. It looks like Winter Wyvern will probably be the zoner. This makes sense because Undyne is a lot better at harassing. Obviously, Arctic Burn is really good, but the cooldown is so long that you're kind of limited every 50 seconds. So we'll just probably see a little bit of trading going on between Undyne and the Night Stalker and some attempt at reducing the Shadow Fiend's farm.
And we'll indeed see Raging Potato, of course, this time on the Whimranger, as opposed to Weehaw himself, who was on it in the game one. And bottom lane, Cuckoo, taking a fair bit of harassment. Didn't skill that blink first, went for the mana break, the more aggressive point to take at this stage, so we can trade hits here with the opponents.
And one really good thing that Secret has here is a Dazzle versus an Anti-Mage. It's by far one of the best support counters, at least in the early game. In the late game, it's a little bit more iffy, but in this stage, Shadow Wave does physical damage, and you can basically heal the creeps, which does damage in an AoE around them. So every time Anti-Mage comes up for a last hit, you cast a spell, and that's why Cuckoo lost so much HP there, because Shadow Wave does so much, so he has to be so careful. There it is again. Went for a last hit, the Shadow Wave from Dazzle, and Puppy is just pressuring the crap out of the stool lane.
I mean, and they need to do this as well, because if Cuckoo gets ahead, if he gets a good timing on the Manta Star, you look at Secret's lineup in terms of stuns, and they're pretty much relying on the Ravage at the later portions to catch out the Anti-Mage.
Yeah, that's basically going to be a repeat of what we had last game, but Dazzle's putting so much pressure here on AM that I think things are going really well for Secret, and it's also guaranteeing that Tidehunter gets some experience.
Indeed, time and time again, Cuckoo just getting incredibly low, down to the final tango in a salve. As of course, got Jules backing him up there on that Wyvern, and still just level 1 at 2. We might see him get that point in the Cold Embrace so we can allow the Anti-Mage to stick around and farm topped up. And so the top lane matchup, one that we haven't really talked about, but the Darkseer going up against this Queen of Pain. Expect both heroes to do alright here?
Yeah. Pretty easy for Darkseer to get last hits. Eternal Envy on the Queen of Pain likely won't take that much damage from the Iron Shell. So Ryo can do a couple tricky things, as Darkseers always can, like getting extra farm, but with Pylite Eye shifting up here, it should be an advantage that goes back to Envy now. Although, have you seen much Envy Quap?
It's definitely not one of the ones that he normally goes for. The fact that they picked up both the Quap and the Asset, it's going to be really interesting to see how it works out for the man. It's quite a different playstyle, of course, from the Ember Spirit that we saw him go for in game one.
In some ways, yeah, but in other ways, I would say Ember is very much so an early game hero for a carry. He can be really aggressive, he can rotate and get kills, and as long as Envy's able to do that as well, then I think he's going to be just fine.
Yeah.
Slight misplay here from Jules on the safe lane. A lot of damage done to Misery, but he's got boots. He's going to be...
Look at this double damage on Jesse Vash. The creeps plucking him off a little bit. Puppy's there with a backup, so indeed, it's going to be a little bit too hard for Mineski to go on. And he's going to be A-OK, and yeah, top lane as we saw, Pylodai now rotating in, just trying to do what he can to harass back the Darks here.
And despite that really good pressure in the start, Cuckoo here on the Anti-Mage is able to catch up to the last hits. I think the reason it's a bit low is dual lanes in the mid lane and the off lane versus the safe Quap is a bit of a weird matchup in the sense that Darkseer makes last hitting a little hard because it's going to be under tower and the Iron Shells are making things hard to predict. So not too surprised to see all the last hits fairly low this game.
Indeed, in the mid lane matchup at the moment, pretty even between the two of them. 16 for 3 on Weehaw, 14 for 5 on Potato. So, obviously having that presence of both of the supports earlier on in the game has worked out for them both, and they'll keep on par. And Weehaw, of course, he's playing the SF on the Dire side. We see a lot of teams like to pick it up on the Radiant because of the easier potential to back up and clear out the stacks. This time, he's going to rely on his supports more so to do that and create those stacks for him. And we can see already Puppy in the jungle starting to make those up for the Shadow Fiend.
Yeah, Puppy's progression here was great. He started in the off lane, he pressured the crap out of the Anti-Mage, limited his last hit, so he's slightly behind where he would have been before. And, you know, maybe if you get lucky, you can get a kill as well. And this also forced the Undyne to shift over as well. So it kind of accomplished a lot of things here and really did a lot. And now he goes back, stacks to anticipate helping out the Shadow Fiend. And now he can say, okay, I've pressured the map enough. I need to go back and be a little greedy for myself and to do that, he'll pull.
Jules is stuck on the Winter Wyvern there. Got himself in a bit of a tricky position with the Arctic Burn. So, I mean, Pilotai's going to come up and, okay, Jesse Vash gets him out there. The Tango, Pilotai, we're coming right round into the two of them here. Perhaps avoid down onto Jules. He's got that movement speed, though, here during the night time, so he's going to be all right. He may back off, though, into a potential whim range, and he needs to be aware of a Shackle Shot. Now, it looks like Raging Potato's just looking to clear up the camp here, so Pilotai's going
to
be all right.
He didn't just come to harass Jules. He also placed a really good Observer Ward that's going to spot exactly where the supports are rotating. So now Shadowfiend knows how aggressive he can be, because they'll see where the Undyne is. If Undyne's not going mid, then he only has to worry about dying to Wind Ranger, which is pretty unlikely, frankly. It's more opposite to have the opposite happen. So Weehaw's going to be able to get a bit extra last hits and advantage out of this mid lane because of that really good Observer Ward.
Well, Jesse Vash and Pilotai still just keeping the attention of each other. Bottom lane, we're seeing them do their best to harass Misery back there. He's certainly not finding the greatest of CS, but he's getting what a Tidehunter needs, and he's getting the levels here at the moment.
Yeah, levels are really what it's about. You hit level 6, you go back to base, and then you organize a gank with somewhere, you get a kill with it, and ultimately you'll go back to farming when your Ravage is down and try to pick up a Blink Dagger. And once you get a Blink, things can be very good for their team. They don't have a lot of follow-up is the only downside, but if they get a good Ravage, it'll allow Envy to set up a better ulti with the Scream. Things like that will make a big difference.
And we are now in the mid lane. It is starting to break ahead of the Windranger, 35 compared to the 22, and that is still with the stack being there, the puppy's created. So he's going to have that as well to create even more of a distance between himself and the Windranger. Top lane, Envy, nearly level 7, has got that Sonic Wave. So Raya has to be careful how close he gets to getting low. You've got Puppy as well hanging around, maybe seeing if they can go for something. At the moment, 6 minutes in, still no first blood yet coming into sight for either side.
He actually stood there to block the camp because that prevented Ryo from being able to pull that. So by him standing there, it means a little bit less farm coming to Darkseer. Puppy gets a single pull off, which normally would push the lane. This is fine because Ryo's always pushing the lane in the counterbalance. So Puppy gets a little bit of levels. He slightly denies what Darkseer gets, and overall a very marginal advantage going to Secret with this play.
And Nightstalker just trying to get some levels there in the mid lane. Only level 2 at the moment on Pilotai. You've got your level 6 coming out on Cuckoo. Halfway through level 5 on Misery.
That's so leveled. For an offlane hero, this is amazing. If he was here by himself at the start, Undyne or Winter Wyvern could have sold his own.
They want to go straight in with the Mana Void. It doesn't do a lot of damage level 1, but it looks with the Splinter Blast and the Tombstone, they're going to get the first blood, and it will go the way of Cuckoo there. So Mineski finding what they were looking for and finally managing to get a kill on the board there.
It's actually a great dueling combo to kill Tidehunter. Tidehunter is very strong to physical right clicks, so heroes that have to do a lot of those to kill somebody, it's a little bit weak, but with Undyne you have Decay, lowers his strength and does magic damage. Slurp does magic damage. Splinter Blast does magic damage. They actually dealt with him very, very easily. And a nice use of Mana Void as well. Even though it didn't do that much damage, every little bit helps in terms of magic.
Indeed, that's going to be as close as Treadstone. Pilotai on the Nightstalker will be looking for that urn. And Misery, he's more than halfway towards getting those arcanes. And they'll continue to trade the farm. And maybe at this point, we'll see the supports be okay. Envy top lane. Very nice indeed. Managed to move in there with the Sonic Wave and burst down the Darkseer. Looks like Ryo did not expect that one, hiding behind the tier 1.
Did you expect that one?
I don't think the Observer did. No, we love you, Pim.
It's somebody else's fault, not ours, right? So, pretty good kill there for Envy. He's going to be on cooldown for a while, but this is a period of time where Queen of Pain usually is a little passive. It would be nice to have his ult if he was worried about Mineski actually roaming and ganking, but they don't really have the best ganking supports. Winter Wyvern and Undyne aren't really known for that. But with that said, Jules is actually doing pretty good on levels. He's almost level 6. He just hit 5 here. And when he does hit 6, ganking for him is actually a real possibility that could happen.
Yeah, especially if they manage to do it in tandem with the Darkseas. Ryo's been having a great time at the top. Level 7, he's really recovered from the fact that he was getting harassed back at the start. He's starting to get that CS. Envy looking to wrap around potentially. Same time, mid lane, they're going down Pilotai down with the Focus Fire. They'll get it. Raging Potato picks up that kill. And a second pickoff now for Mineski.
That's a really big kill. Not really expecting Wind Rangers in most cases to get CS. I feel like Raging Potato is doing worse in this lane, though, than he should be. Like, obviously, Weehaw's playing Shadowfiend, and Shadowfiend can farm very rapidly, and he got stacks, but he's sitting, like,
double
half of
CS.
The CS.
Yeah.
I really feel like
it's a big difference.
A top-tier Wind Ranger player like Sumail or something like that would be able to be semi-competitive in matchups that aren't maybe in his advantage. So I feel like he has been all less hit a bit. He did get pressured a little bit as well, but his CS is quite a ways behind Shadow Fiends, and that could really add up over the course of the game.
Cuckoo now with the Perseverance. Of course, looking for the as best of a timing as he can get on that battle here. And, of course, Envy, we're yet to see him leave the lane. Level 8 at the moment. At this point, is he just relying on the Quap to farm up the first item, maybe something like an Orchid, and then look to be a little bit more mobile across the map?
It's definitely going to be an Orchid game, yeah. Just because it helps him kill the Wind Ranger, it helps him really pressure the Anti-Mage. So there's a huge timing window there. If you get your Orchid at a really early time, like before Anti-Mage gets Manta, which is more towards the 20-minute mark. So if you get your Orchid any time before 20 minutes, Anti-Mage is a pretty straightforward gank. Queen of Pain plus one other damage source means a dead Anti-Mage. Now, they don't have the best damage sources this game. It's a Dazzle, a Night Stalker, Shadow Fiend isn't that mobile, so it's hard for him to gank the AM, but the Orchid alone will give them a lot of options towards shutting down this Anti-Mage and delaying his Manta style, which is really where he gets strong at team fighting. So Orchid is definitely going to be the play here.
I want to talk about this, a bit of an unusual one coming out from Weehaw. Brown Boots, Akila, Shadow Blade.
Not weird at all, man. He's been doing this all tournament.
Okay.
Grabs the Shadow Blade, and this allows him to help gank the Anti-Mage.
I mean, this is the Weehaw build, then. It's not something that other SFs normally emulate.
I mean, it is a very, very old school build, and going back pubs like 6 years and stuff like that, Shadow Fiends would consistently build Shadow Blade, but it's coming back a little in the pro scene just because it turns the Shadow Fiend from a passive sieging hero who would normally grab like Mech, Sanjin Yasha, BKB, into a hero that can grab Shadow Blade, get a kill or two using an ultimate, like a freebie kill, and then buying those tanky items. So it's just a slightly different playstyle. It's more oriented around ganks, and that's exactly what he's going
to
try for.
Absolutely. Straight up, as soon as he comes out, moves to the bottom lane, he's going to look to try and set up. He's got the level 2 Requiem, looking for the timing.
Oh, the sentry. They've watched the replays. Yeah. They know Weehaw is going to go for those kind of things. And
oh, Shackle onto Envy, landing onto the one tree next to him there. Vacuum back as well, but they don't quite have the control. Envy will be able to blink it out. Misery is there and does have that Ravage if they want to try and turn. Sonic Wave is up as well. If Mineski come too close to this Tidehunter, Misery may just want to look to pop it. They're coming up the lane. Dark Misery's here. There hiding. He's going to move forward. There's your Ravage. Sonic Wave to follow up as well. Straight into the middle. There's one. They get the Shadow Strike out to Potato. He did get the Wind Run off, but I'm sure they'll chase this down for a second kill. TP reactions are coming through, and that's going to be enough to turn this. They're going to force Misery back. They've got the Arctic Burn slowed down. Envy's still sticking about for this. In fact, he blinks forward. He wants to try and get the kill, but he can't quite close the gap. And that slows on him. Envy
so
could
close.
Be in trouble. He's desperate
Power
for the kill.
One.
There we go. He does get it. But now, is he going to be able to get himself out? He's got a TP. He's going to blink in 2 seconds. I think he's going to be fine. He's going to get away with this. He blinks. He TPs. He got the kill,
man.
And he gets himself home. Envy.
That was looking scary, man. That Arctic Burn helped so much. Envy blinked aggressively, and he was just a bit too far away. Wind Ranger was trying to kite, but just didn't have the cooldown on her abilities. Maybe if she didn't waste a Shackle Shot on the Tidehunter, she could have killed Envy there, but she did use it. I'm sure that was one of the factors that said Envy felt comfortable going for that dive. So really well played by him getting that kill.
Oh, Winter's Curse, straight up onto Pylite Die, trying to look to set up a killer for Cuckoo, but the Sick Charges are there, and the Mana Void, it's not going to do too much. We'll just force Secret back. Fairly low, and there is backup coming from Mineski if they want to try and jump in behind the tower. The Creep Wave pushing through, and Pylite Die realizes he's got to get himself out. He'll TP back to base. Envy continuing to pressure onto the mid, and thanks to that kill as well, more than halfway towards finishing off that Orchid now on this Queen of Pain.
Yeah, every kill that he gets is so important because it's making it harder for Anti-Mage to get that second item. He's getting close to his battlefield. Again, another Sentry Ward going to spot out Weehaw. Shadowblade not really providing a lot other than allowing him to farm a little faster and move around the map undetected. Also means that his opponents, it's going to cost them money just to gank the Shadow Fiend in addition to their time. So the Shadowblade does have a lot of uses here. And even if he hasn't gotten a kill yet with his ultimate, it still makes a huge threat. The supports can't just idly sit next to a creep wave and farm there. They have to sit together. They have to sit by sentries. They have to spend their very little money on protecting their carries. And it limits them in other ways. Wyvern would love to have an Arcane Boots right now. He would have them if he didn't have to buy that pair of sentries earlier.
Certainly putting the pressure onto Mineski, but it looks like this is going to be the chance that Mineski are going to take to look for some pressure of their own. They're smoked up, moving towards the bottom. They've got both Weehaw and Pylite Die here on the side of Secret. We'll see if they can get the jump here. Are they going to be able to do this, though? Because they're fairly tanky. Pylite Die's caught between three. Jesse Vash is also moving in. Pylite Die looking to see if he can take the courier. He's going to pop the Night Tower, but the slows are too much. He's trying to get himself out of there, but the vacuum's down, and they'll get themselves the Night Stalker. So they take down the NS. He will be out for the count. In top lane, Secret, I will manage to find the tier 1 trade and boost of travel now. picked up here on this, and Misery's thinking about it, but Raging Potato with that haste rune, a little bit too speedy.
Oh, the shackle on Envy.
Oh, latching Jupiter, they got the damage though with the Witch's Curse. They should do as well. They'll take the kill onto Envy. Lovely play there from Raging and Jules, and they'll try and look for more. Chasing down Misery here with this haste rune. There's your boots to travel. Weeha coming in. The Ravage, and he's going to look for the raises. He takes down the kill onto Windranger. They'll try and see if he can get some more. And meanwhile, in the mid lane, Puffy's caught out by them, but it'll Shallowgrave himself heal up as well. Looking for the raises onto Jules, getting himself into the sidelines.
He
in the mid lane, Puppy lived, he got himself out, and now Jesse Vash trying to chase back onto Pylai Dine. It looks like it will just be Envy and Potato going down there. No one else to fall.
Man, that Winter Wyvern ult was so smart. It prevented the Ravage from coming. If the Ravage happened, they were probably not going to get that kill, but it guaranteed the extra stun. The Ravage was delayed, and they scored that kill. Windranger did go a little overly aggressive. I don't know if he saw or heard the TP or not, but that Ravage absolutely wrecked him. And luckily, Weeha made the right play as well. He didn't wait for the Requiem. He just did the easy hit raise because there was no wind run. So, okay. Nice plays there by both teams, really.
And Misery now, he's got the mech complete here on the Tidehunter. And Envy just short of the goal for the recipe for his completed Orchid. And you look, of course, the Anti-Mage did finish off that Battle Fury now, so the farm game's going to step up, and we'll see if he's going to be able to close that gap between himself and the SF at the moment, sitting about 1.7k on top of him at the moment.
Yeah, really good aggressive wards for taking this tower. Pi's in the position to attack from the back. If they go from the front, Misery's got Ravage. No, he doesn't have Ravage anymore, but he does have a mech at least to protect his allies. That Splinter Blast did so much damage.
It's going to be the mech coming out. They'll come in there. We'll take the tower. Secret's still moving forward and maybe even thinking about fighting here. Raya did now put a skill point into the wall. He was holding it off until level 10.
A little delayed. You could maybe argue that he should have had one earlier, but I don't think it was going to make a difference in any of the ganks that happened thus far. So just cared more about Vacuum, I guess.
And again, a pretty careful game between both sides. With 16 minutes in, it's just 4-for-4, but both are looking for blood now, especially with that Orchid done on the Quap. Secret, fairly deep here at the moment, Mineski. Actually smoked up around the mid lane, hoping that Secret were going to come in for a bit of action. It's not going to happen in especially 25 seconds until that Ravage is back online for Misery. They'll probably want to wait for that before they try and fight again.
Instead, they just...
They just gonna go?
Focus on mid. Smoke was used by Secret. They're gonna come from the back. Jesse Vash in trouble.
Yeah, drops down the tombstone here. They'll focus that. Take it down. There's your curse. They want to Misery. The wall's down as well. It's a lot of illusions. But Weave comes out here from Puppy.
Ravage
Secret's still looking pretty good. They're focusing the attention towards the Darkseer. Pop the mech, but he's gonna get popped himself. That's the Darkseer down. Puppy shallowgraving himself. Mech comes through Misery. There's your Mana Void. Secret's gonna fall here. And this illusion here of the Shadow Fiend doing a fair bit. Weeha looking for the record. The Sonic Wave as well. He's actually gonna hold on to the record because they don't need it. Double kill from the SF as he manages to raise down the Undying as well. And it looks like this one will end as a 3-for-1 and Secret do come out on top. Even though it was a very nice curse and a very nice wall, it just wasn't enough against the sustain, the heal that Puppy could provide.
It was just a perfect positioning from Secret, basically. Maneski really didn't expect to be attacked from the back. They thought maybe from the top, through the river, from the left side, right side river. It came from the back, and Secret's positioning there just gave them really good tactical information. You could maybe criticize the Radiant Wards a bit. It's going to get spotted by Envy.
Did just blink into this. I don't know if Envy's going to have the damage. It's going to be...
Very close.
Yeah, he should be fine. 2 points in the shield.
If he had ult, easy kill. But he did use it in that fight, so... A rare no kill on Anti-Mage there when he gets Orchided by Queen of Pain.
And that's got to be a bit... That, going back to that last team fight, it's got to be a worry for Mineski. Because they did use the curse, they used the wall, and they lost to a team fight to Secret. And Secret didn't even use the Ravage, and they didn't even need to use the Requiem on Weeha as well.
Well, actually, Tidehunter is kind of a good Winter's Curse target, really, because he's got damage block. If his allies hit him, he's going to be taking a whole lot less of that. Plus, his armor is high. You know, that wasn't really a huge amount of damage. I wasn't sure if Shadow Fiend was in there or not. That would be the one hero they have that could do a lot to him. But killing him during that is really going to be about focusing him down with their cores. And they just don't have a lot of burst damage. Normally, you'd expect to see, like, a Queen of Pain on an average team nowadays. But they didn't have any magic bursts like that. It's... Like, they can damage Amp with Undying, but it isn't until Anti-Mage gets really farmed, or Windranger gets a good focus fire on the person that they Winter's Curse, until that person is really me threatened. So, it's going to be a while until Winter's Curse really feels strong, other than for the defensive standpoint, like the fact that it stuns.
Pylai Dai moving in top. Shackle's not going to latch to get the silence onto Raging Misery, and Envy are there as well. They'll look to get the kill on the Windranger, and they'll get it. He's now down for 50 seconds.
No stun. I thought he was going to get stunned, dude. Did you see that net creep?
I didn't actually.
What if they used a Helm of the Dominator on the net creep and then stunned him with that? That would have been cool. If there was a Helm of the Dominator.
Well, nonetheless, they get the kill. And they're maybe even looking for more. They're starting to push down mid. SMY is now done by Weeha as well. And he's already looking pretty. He's 2k still ahead of this Anti-Mage.
Yeah.
Anti-Mage furiously trying to farm up and trying to do what he can, but he's still got a fair way to go before the side of Secret are really going to be scared of him.
I feel like Secret's definitely winning the vision and mobility war. They're moving in good positions. Their wards are not getting dewarded, whereas Mineski's wards are getting dewarded. Like, they've got some decent ones here, but they're pretty standard spots. And Secret just seems to be on the better page for that. And it's so important. The last fight was won because Secret had better wards and they had better positioning. Tis
mine. Well, Pilardai leading it in towards the mid. You're going to get Weeha coming in with his Shadow Blade. And Darkseer could be in trouble there if they get the Void Slayer. Mid lane Puppy's being chased. Look at the fear. There's your Void. And here's the damage here from this Shadow Fiend. Weeha now dominating as he picks up yet another kill.
And the early BOTs as well. This is something that not many players do, but Weeha definitely does. He goes for Shadow Blade, Sanjin Yasha, Boots of Travel. He loses some HP and some attack speed, but the mobility that he gets when he Shadow Blades is amazing. Like, to be able to catch up to a Darkseer like that. And it in some ways also increases your damage output. Because if you're chasing after somebody that's fast, you spend less time catching up to them between attacks.
And now Jesse Vash, he's caught just outside the base. Weeha trying to move on. Look at this damage. The charges on the stick, just enough to keep him alive. Did actually lose the courier there, the die? And did have the bottle on
this. Anti-Mage, maybe, was the one that got it. Weeha should have been able to get that kill, but he canceled his attack a bit earlier. So small mistake there, but he's not going to feel too bad about it.
Oh, Raging Potato. He needs to get himself out. He's got a win run. He's got a TP and hope for the best. He's looking to hide here. Can they get the cancel? Can they get the vision? Yes, they can. They've got the Void out, and that's going to be Potato going down. Another pick off for Secret.
What a huge kill. So that'll be eggs for Windranger, but 1-4-1 on a hero that can do a lot of damage. This is looking bad. Ult on Misery mid.
They've got Kuka moving in as well, but Misery is just going to pop the Greaves to try and walk it off.
The Ravage
Shining Wave onto 4. Misery will still go down. Secret, do they have to follow up to clean this one up? They've got a Cold Embrace onto Kuka, keeping him alive. Envy trying to move forward with a Scream Burst. They can't quite get the Anti-Mage. Shadow Strike's going to tick him down. He's going to look for the TP back to base, and he's going to be all right. Gets himself back to the Fountain. So Secret, even though the combo was there, it just wasn't enough damage to get themselves a kill.
That was a huge fight for Mineski there. They got him to waste Ravage, so Tidehunter is pretty useless for the next minute, 2 minutes. They did use a couple ultimates themselves, but...
I mean, Sonic Wave down as well. That's gone for 100 seconds.
That was huge that they were able to save him. The benefit of Winter Wyvern, AM, pretty good combo. He's already super magic resistant. Throw some physical immunity on top of that, and he's in a good place. And if you look at his skill build, he's adjusted for this. No stat points, man. He's got 3 levels in Spell Shield, and I think that was a really nice reaction to what he's playing against here. A lot of magic coming out of Secret.
So Mineski's certainly holding at this point. And Weeha coming into lane. We've got a Windranger on the high ground. Would love to try and find a Shackle if he comes too close in this sentry there. It was, of course, getting the vision of Weeha as he came in.
These wards are just so dominant for Secret. Oh, I'm sorry, this is a Radiant Ward. That one's really useful. But this one over here by the Dire, super, super great ward. Spots all of their movements. They see, okay, Mineski is turtling right now. That's pretty clear. I mean, they can't really gank until they have Winter's Curse. They've made that clear, right? It's their best range disable. They're using it just to stun and set up kills.
On top lane, you've got Pilardai out on his own.
Does he have eggs? No,
he's,
but he has
halfway
vision.
He's halfway there.
I think you just saw them with regular vision.
Smoke from Secret. Cuckoo is there. The Cuckoo's actually just blinked forward here. He's in the trees, though. I don't think they're aware of it.
The smoke could break as Puppy.
They already put the wheel
inside. They saw the blink.
Oh, Cuckoo.
Will they get him? All right, smoke breaks. They know he used to be there. They're going to keep looking for him, I think.
He's going to TP out, and they can't. They don't really have anything to do.
They don't even have blink daggers yet. They can't find him. So he's going to be okay there. Any new items on the map? Not that much.
Envy finished his BKB on top of the Orchid. That was his item of choice. And over on the side of Mineski, other than the Ags, as we were saying, being done. They did pick up the Greaves just before the Ags on the Windranger for the Darkseer. I think that's the Manta style, obviously done for Anti-Mage.
Oh, he doesn't have Manta. He got found by Quap. But Envy didn't go for it because he's like, oh, he's just going to have Manta, no problem. It's one of those times where you should probably just do it anyways just to test him. see what happens. But it's so hard to read that situation. If he just starts running after he gets orchided, it could just be Anti-Mage waiting until something more serious hits him, like a dagger.
Oh,
it's very hard to read.
There's
that.
Not a sentry top. Okay, there is. Yeah, there is a sentry top. Rhino straight away.
But look at those sentries on the map. There's five sentries. That's five. Well, it's not 500. Yeah, it's 500 gold. Each one is 100 gold. So that's 500 gold that one of these supports doesn't have. The Undying, to be specific. And this guy's nothing. He's got a Wands and an Arcane Boots. And he's forced to buy all these because he bought a Shadow Blade. We do see Puppy go down. So they get one kill at least. But for a five-position support that has no farm himself, it's not really what they need. The Shadow Blade completely paid off, honestly. It's one of the things it does. Shadow Fiend farms fast. He buys this item that's useful for him. Maybe not the best, but... And then he counters his enemy supports as well.
Cuckoo looking for some aggressive jungling here. Over the other side, Weeha is around. Is he going to try for this? Oh, he's going to go for the TP anyway. Cuckoo nowhere to stop it. And the Anti-Mage is playing this sense, but he's still managing to keep himself relevant, still just behind the Shadow Fiend. Hasn't quite been able to get himself right on top because he's not been able to find himself in a huge fight for everyone beside Mineski. About 25 minutes in, 7 to 10, the fights haven't really been that frequent.
Yeah, I don't really like this, his net worth right now. It doesn't make Mineski look like they're in a good position. Anti-Mage just should be ahead of everybody else. Like, Weeha has basically just farmed incredibly fast to be able to keep his net worth up this high. And he's got the right items to deal with SF as well. He's got the Talisman now, so even if he does get stunned and he jumps in and Mantis, the mana drain that's coming out from the illusions won't be as fast as they'd be expecting. Like, Anti-Mage needs at least one item right now to be competitive with SF, and he's not there.
And also the fact that the Windrange is going to be going for the BKB next, so there's not going to be any MKB coming out anytime soon for any of the heroes on the side of Mineski. So, as you said, the evasion is going to be absolutely huge there for Weeha. Misery, I'm still looking for that Blink Dagger on top of the Grease. 1200 gold to, on the way to it. And
a Solar Crest. We literally just mentioned they don't have a way to deal with evasion. And now he's got an extra 25% that he can throw on the Shadow Fiend when Shadow Fiend
goes
high ground.
Disgusting.
So Secret is very likely going to go do some pushing here.
Well,
or they'll wait until they
this mid, but there is a sentry. Jules is going to see it, but he's only going to see his own demise potentially. We'll drop the Winter's Curse, but Puppy and Pylai die there. They'll clean up the Wyvern.
I don't think that was worth it. I mean, he could have ulti'd, TP'd. I guess he also had the Glimmer Cape, but...
Oh, Manta is there for Cuckoo. He's going to blink back, but he blinks into Misery, and Misery does have a Ravage if they want to try and control the aim, and they will. They'll pop the Ravage. They
all
get
right,
the damage there with the physical burst from Puppy. It counts as a double kill as he moves across from that Wyvern kill in the mid lane. And very nicely done there by Secret, just positioning them ready for the blink out from the Anti-Mage.
Yeah, the best part, the best play there was that Misery waited a while to Ravage. He hit him with a Gush, he attacked him a couple times, and then he Ravaged. He needed to buy time for his team to back up, and he knew that as soon as Anti-Mage blinked, he had 5 seconds until he could get away again. So count to five, then Ravage, then let your team back you up. Gives you like 7 seconds to kill Anti-Mage.
And with that kill, I imagine Misery's, yeah, he's only a few hundred gold now away from the Blink Dagger.
He's in a really good position, yeah. And they have a good amount of Arcane Boots too. I think it's just his Greaves, but that should be enough to help out. Now, Mineski still could get a little lucky on things like Mana Void. Like, Queen of Pain, for example, has a really big mana pool. If she gets drained, if they initiate on her, for example, drain her mana and throw the Mana Void out, it could potentially wipe Secret. They have some options here. But with Anti-Mage's farm dipping behind even of Queen of Pain's right now, it's looking to be a bad place for them. He also went back for a Vladza, an item that lets him lifesteal and passively farm.
Jesse but, hiding. I'm not going to look for him. Oh, actually canceling the TP, but maybe that's because they want to try and defend this tier 2.
Okay, yeah, I think you're right here.
They might want to try and come with you. They're sending people down. They want to try and fight this one. Jesse, he's going to move in. There's your tombstone drop. We are getting blocked a little bit by his own creeps, but he's a little bit too speedy with these boots of travel and this SM1. They just aren't going to be able to chase him.
He would have had to use that a little earlier when Secret was still a little bit far forward. But I'm sure he was scared. He has almost no items. If he would have been out of position, like if Night Stalker would have found him as soon as he comes out, he just would have died if he went a little too early. But it's hard for him to know how many people are actually there.
The ping's coming out now into Roshan. Secret spot that one out. And at this point, I'm going to feel very comfortable going for that. Mineski, unlikely to try and contest this one. If Secret do want to try and move in, and Edbling's going to be coming out in Misery, so... At the same time, maybe Secret just don't feel any rush in particular to do so. And we already see that Envy's working on finishing that Assault Cuirass that he's going to be very close to. Just needs the money there for the final bit of armor. And then we'll have an Assault Cuirass on this corp as well. There we go. Back into the pit. Envy with the DD. I'll take the Roche. Nightstalker now with the Aghanims here, Pilot Eye. And that's a butterfly on Weeha. So some massive item pickups coming for the side of Secret. And you've just got to ask, what's Mineski's answer going to be to this one?
It's looking really bad for them. They're going to go high ground. They're two items ahead of a couple important heroes. Windranger has 9,000 net worth. Queen of Pain's like six ahead of that. That's like two items. It's going to be really tough. He can't even get close to matching up against Weeha. Like, a BKB is not going to save Windranger here. I think she should have just gone damage. MKB immediately after the Aghs would have been the only way. But now she's got a BKB, which, yeah, it'll make her magic immune and stop the slows and the misses, but, or at least the misses from Crippling Fear, but I don't, and the Ravage, but I don't know if that'll be enough.
Online, Pilot Eye, just give me a bit of harassment here to Cuckoo, rest of the side of Secret. Still putting on the pressure. We already saw Weeha just head up to the high ground, get the punches in onto the tower. And he's got the sustain of Puppy there on the Dazzle behind him, so he knows that he can do this.
They have every piece. They have an Initiator, they have a core that can tank, they have somebody giving them vision. Secret has, their lineup is perfect here.
This is so good. It's looking to be that unstoppable force at this point. Look at the racks just melt. There's a focus fire, but he just doesn't care. It's not doing any damage with the Solar Crest laid down onto Weeha. He's evading half of the shots. They'll attempt for a Shackle, they'll move Cuckoo in, but he just turns around and hits back at the Anti-Mage, and they've got to walk themselves back off.
This is the reason Shadow Fiend is so popular right now and seen so valuable. From the side, Jesse Bash.
They'll drop a wall here, Mineski, but they've lost the Undying. We are just playing around the wall. It's going to be the mid lane racks gone. And now they head down to the bottom to look for more. Cuckoo blinking out. And Envy's going to blink forward. Cuckoo popping the Manta. They'll get the silence on the right one. Envy's lost a lot of mana. He will now pop the BKB. Try and right click back onto Cuckoo. They'll take down the Anti-Mage. Unstoppable for Weeha as he also takes down the Winter Wyvern. And only two left on the map for Mineski. Secret having a pretty insane game. Game one, we saw them struggle a bit in the early game against Mineski, but they turned it up for the late game, and in this game, Secret, they've been turned on from the start.
They're just completely outclassing Mineski in this game. They got so much more farm naturally. There's the Ravage initiation.
It's straight in, and they'll look to find some kills with this one. Right, we'll pop the Greaves. There'll be a buyback from Anti-Mage. Nice mana void onto Envy. Envy will blink himself out. They'll put the Manta, look towards Misery. It's a vacuum, but there's no wall to follow up at this point, and Puppy's there with the Shadow Waves. They'll heal themselves back up, and Weeha just continues to sit there, go for the objectives, hit Zorax, and they'll take a second set down away from the side of Mineski hit.
I don't even think they leave. Go back top lane. They continue. I guess they're low on mana. All right, they're playing this ultra safe. Secret wants no chance of going to loser bracket. I don't even know if they need to, though. I mean, Mineski is so far behind in farm. They still have the Aegis. They're just going to go back. They're going to farm for about 40 seconds, and then they're going to go back top, and they're going to end the game. I just really think that Secret clearly outclassed Mineski this game. They farmed faster than in all categories. They completely won the mid lane. Weeha's been out-farming an Anti-Mage consistently, even though he got a relatively fast timing on the Battle Fairy. Oh, he's going to go for the kill on Cuckoo.
Okay, Cuckoo taking on the edge here. Will blink out, so won't be able to quite find the damage for the kill. Scaring away the Anti-Mage. But yeah, as you said, the fact that this Shadow Fiend 8k ahead of this Anti-Mage.
Yeah, I almost feel a little bad for Mineski in the sense that, don't you think they would have rather been matched up against somebody else in the winner bracket round? I think they're a very good team and they definitely can match up against some of the other teams, but against Secret, arguably one of the best teams, top two, top three teams in the entire tournament, they're very far behind this game.
And there we go, MP just moving forward. There's an MKB now on Weeha as well. It's just getting scary and scary. Mineski are smoked up. They're going to look for an engagement. They've got all the ultimates. It's Misery, the one that's revealing himself at the moment in the lane. At the same time, Envy's going to find the pick up onto Windranger, so they've already taken out Raging Potato. Cuckoo will blink himself out, and they'll enter the fight here. Envy, they'll drop the wall on him, but the BKB's out from the man. There's just Sonic Wave flying through. He does actually clip both Jules and the Darkseer. They'll get off the Winter's Curse. Turning on to Envy, can they actually kill him in time? No, it's a double kill for Envy. Monster kill streak for Weeha. Make that a triple kill. And Secret playing on a totally different level to that of Mineski in this game, and they take it 33 minutes in, 20-7, Purge.
They made that look pretty straightforward, honestly. Won all their lanes, got the items they needed. Yeah, they died here and there. Mineski had a couple good ganks and stuff like that, but they just consistently stayed ahead in farm, in warding. They always knew where their opponents were, and they never let them get a really good team fight.
Absolutely not. And we saw, though, in game one, Mineski, there's still a bit of hope for them. These guys, they can step it up, but as we saw there, they